Members, I now call to order the meeting. We have a quorum now. Today, this is the meeting of the Subcommittee on Matters Relating to Railways under the panel on transport. Item 1 on the agenda, confirmation of minutes. Paper number 1339/2013/14, that's the minutes of the meeting held on the 3rd of January. The minutes have been forwarded to members. We haven't received any comments, so can we confirm the minutes? Thank you. Item 2 on the agenda. Information papers issued since the last meeting. We've received 6 sets of papers. For paper under item 2 related to item 3 and 4, that you could refer to them under items 3 and 4. Members, you know, the board, if you put it up, then we can't see, and we think maybe there's no one behind, and then maybe we won't have a quorum then. Item 3, item for discussion at the next regular meeting on the 4th of July. Paper numbers 1328/13-13(01) and (02). There are a list of outstanding items for discussion and list of follow-up actions. We propose, or the administration proposes, to discuss railway development beyond 2020. That's item 6 on the list of outstanding items for discussion. So that's what the administration has proposed. Members, do you agree we take up that item at the next regular meeting? Long-term railway development beyond 2020. Any other suggestions, please? Mr. James Doe, you support the idea? No objection? Members, I wonder if we could finish the item today on the express rail link. Maybe at the next meeting we still have to talk about the express rail link. If you schedule another item, unless there will be a special meeting in between, you know, to be realistic, I don't think we could finish asking questions today. Thank you, Mr. James Toe. Actually, that's what I'm going to talk about next. The next regular meeting is on the 7th of July. And the administration has proposed to take up the item of long-term railway development. If members have no objection, we'll take up that item at that meeting. And what I'd like to inform you is, or propose, is that in June, we will have an additional meeting. That is under the express rail link, the financial arrangement between the Hong Kong, between the government and the MAN-TRCL. That is, the government pays for the cost, and then rent will be collected. How do the two parties share the rent and so on? Because many asked whether the MTRCL should pay the land premium on the sharing of commercial revenues. Is it appropriate, and so on. So at that same meeting, I would also propose that we take up discussion on the various incidents, of the frequent incidents involving the MTRCL recently, you know, in particular the signaling problems, the auto start of the system, and so on, because the MTRCL has not yet given a response on those incidents. So I propose an additional meeting in June for those two items. Let me finish. On top of that, if, say, today we couldn't finish our discussion on the express rail link today, then on the 19th of May, 2 weeks later, we will take up discussion again on this matter. If we still could not finish on the 19th of May, then between the 19th of May and the June meeting I've proposed, we will find another slot. Now, the 19th of May, I think we've found a room. What about the time? 10:45 a.m. So if necessary, we will have an additional meeting on the 19th of May, 10:45. As for the June meeting, if members agree we hold a meeting in June, I think I have to talk to the secretary. He is in agreement with the discussion in principle, but it seems that he has to leave town in June, so we have to schedule our time with him. What do you think, members? Mr. Chen Kam Lam. Mr. Chairman, I think this is an excellent arrangement, and it will allow us enough time to discuss the matter. Because the long-term rail development is important. If we don't take it up in July, then that means we have to wait till the next legislative session. So I can support the arrangement you have just proposed for the several meetings. Okay, then, can we confirm the arrangement as to whether we'll have a meeting on the 19th of May? We'll confirm that again towards the end of the meeting today. Next, let's come to the item agenda item proper today. That is the latest position of the construction of the Hong Kong section of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link. Now, the item is scheduled from 4:40 p.m. to 6:25 p.m., so we're 5 minutes ahead of schedule. The papers, I'm sure you've all got it. I'm not going to repeat the paper number. At this point, perhaps I could invite the administration and the MTRCL to join us. Because, about the meeting procedure, how much time we will leave for them, how much time we leave for handling the motions and so on, we would like them to join us as we talk about that. Before we invite the representatives in, do you have anything else? No? Then let's invite the representative. Yes, Dr. Elizabeth Quart. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sure we would have plenty of questions. I don't think we should. We need to leave time to deal with the motions, because if we couldn't finish asking the questions, it's not possible for us to decide how to vote. Well, let me tell you what I have in mind. Let's see if you agree with me. I will propose that we have a discussion till 6:25 p.m. And I will announce now that there will be an extension of the meeting by 50 minutes, and that 50 minutes will be for dealing with the motions. How about that? And I will also save some time for them to speak. I would like them to hear this discussion, so they know they will watch the time as they speak, and they won't go beyond the time limit. From the administration today, we have the Secretary for Transport and Housing, Professor Anthony Zheng. And representing the MTRCL, we have Dr. Raymond Chen, Chairman, and Mr. Jay Walder, Chief Executive Officer, and their team. I will not introduce each of the representatives one by one. What I'd like to say here, from now until just now, as I said, 6:30 p.m. We will discuss the papers until 6:30 p.m. and then we will set aside 50 minutes for motions. If you want to submit any motions, please do so before 6:30 p.m. Otherwise, I will not deal with them. If you wish to propose any amendments to the motions, again, please make sure you do so before submit the amendments before 6:30 p.m. today. Professor Zheng will first say a few words, and then Dr. Raymond Chen, Mr. J. Walder, and Mr. Cho Tai Chong will also speak. Now, I would like to allow more time for questions from members. So, Professor, please keep your speech to within 8 minutes. Dr. Raymond Chen, Mr. J. Walder, and Mr. Chiu, you will each have 2 minutes. And then the MTRCL would need 9 minutes to present their paper. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. Now, if you give the secretary 8 minutes and the other you know, important figures, only 2 minutes, maybe that's too short. Maybe you can first find out how long it will take them to speak. If they want to speak for 15, 20 minutes, of course you can't allow it. But if you only give Mr. Walder 2 minutes, I don't think we get much from him. Otherwise, we just have to ask the questions. Well, the MTRCL still has another 9 minutes to present the paper. That is, the three will first speak what they like to tell us, and then there will still be 9 minutes for the MTRCL to present the paper. So altogether, they have 15 minutes. And then the secretary has 8 minutes. That's already 23 minutes. If members wish more time for them, fine. But then we will have to cut short the time for members to speak, because I have done some calculation that will only leave us 82 minutes. More than a dozen members wish to speak, 82 minutes, so each round 4 minutes, and we can only allow one round, so it's for members to decide. Mr. Lee Chuck Yen, the 9 minutes, is it the presentation for this paper? I don't think there's a need for this presentation, because what is in the PowerPoint is actually in the paper already submitted to us, so I would suggest we go straight to questions. Of course, if they each wish to state their position at the beginning, they could do so, but I think there is no need to do a presentation of the paper. Okay, let me listen to other members first. Ms. Dr. Kwakaki, same point, Mr. Chairman. If the Secretary would like to present the administration's paper, I'm sure most members have read the paper. If you want to repeat what's in the paper, let's not waste our time. I'm not against giving the MTRCL 15 minutes, but if it's going to repeat what's in the paper already submitted to members, there's no point. Let's leave us more time. Any other points, please, Mr. Chen Kam Nam? Mr. Chairman, maybe they would like to say something not in the paper. They might want to supplement what's in the paper, or maybe they want to highlight some salient points in the paper. I think we should give them time. If they do not need to raise any points in the paper, all the best. But maybe they want to highlight some points. If we don't even allow them time to speak, it is not nice. Well, let's do this. We'll give MTRCL 15 minutes. It's up to them how they use up their 15 minutes, okay? And then the administration 8 minutes, okay? 23 minutes. And then we'll have 82 minutes left, okay? Because I would like to allow as much time as possible for members to speak. Mr. Yip Kok Him, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not a member of this subcommittee, but I would like to attend this meeting to listen to this discussion, you know, a matter of great concern to the whole community. I think we should give them adequate time to state their position. But of course, I hope they won't repeat what's in the paper, because we've already read the papers. But still, we must give them sufficient time. Thank you. Mr. James Tan. Mr. Chairman, yes, I think we should give the administration sufficient time, because as you know, about the background, it involves whether principal official has to step down. It may involve the whole credibility of the government as well, so I think we should give them enough time. Is 8 minutes enough, Ms. Professor? 9 minutes, please? Okay, 9 minutes. I'll give you one moment. I'll read more quickly. So MTRCL, 15 minutes. Is that enough for you? Okay, great. Let's start. Yes, there's something else. Sorry. Let me mention this first. Rules of procedure, Rule 83. That you need to declare whether there's direct or indirect pecuniary interest before you ask questions. Bear that in mind, please, members. Now, okay, let's let them speak. Okay, Professor Zheng. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a very important meeting. The paper submitted by the administration, including the annexes, gives a full account of the delay in the XRL project. We've spoken all we know. Now, for major projects, there would be various risks like ground condition, inclement weather, and so on. It also involves project management and coordination among contractors. Now, where there is delay in the works progress, various recovery and mitigations may have to be adopted. This is rather common. Now, under the report given by the MTRCL, and the Highways Department is also appointed a vetting consultant, so the Highways Department is aware that under different contracts and processes of work, there has indeed been delay, but then the MTRCL has has said that it's confidence that we could resort to various measures to catch up with the delay. Now, by last year, the situation was more pronounced. In May last year, the media quoted an internal document from MTRCL saying that there could be a delay of 1 year and a cost overrun of $4.4 billion. So the Bureau immediately asked MTRC to give a latest report on the assessment on measures taken by MTRC to catch up with the delay. The Highways Department agreed that as long as there would be no other major unforeseen problems, the West Kowloon terminus could still be completed on time and may not be cost overrun. Last year, on the 8th of November, the Permanent Secretary for Transport and Housing Transport asked the MTRCR and the project's director to report the latest progress on the XRL project. It's shown that the target commissioning date of end 2015 may be affected. A briefing was given to me by the Highways Department, and I instructed the department to report to the Subcommittee on Railways at its meeting on the 22nd of November that the completion date could be later than end 2015. Then also explanation must be given about the delays and then the problems encountered. But then on the morning of the 21st of November, the MTRCL called me saying that there's this agreement that we should report to the Subcommittee on Railways at this meeting on the 22nd of November that commissioning would not be possible in end 2015. They stressed that it's still possible for service to start in end 2015. Then that morning, I instructed my colleagues to have an urgent meeting with the MTRCL to find out about the actual position. Now, as I pointed out in the paper in paragraph 45, the Bureau asked various questions, but still the MTRCL said that it had various means to catch up with the delays. It's still possible to complete works in end 2015. So there are differences in our assessment. And after careful consideration, all the factors considered, as spelled out in paragraph 45 of the paper, the Bureau believed that we should let the subcommittee know that it's possible that service could not be commissioned in 2015, but there's still the possibility of the construction works being completed in 2015. So at the meeting on the 22nd of November, as we gave a report to the subcommittee, we said that the major works of the XR project could be completed in 2015. And after the works are completed, there will be the need for testing and trial running, and that will take about 6 to 9 months in general. So that's a report of facts. And then last November, at a meeting with the MTRCL, the Projects Supervision Committee, the MTRCL still emphasized that it would resort to various measures to catch up with the delay, although it couldn't give any details. But it still maintained the target date of 2015, where service could be commissioned. And so the CEO of MTRCL called me urgently on the 12th of April 2014 to say that the works are going to be completed in 2016 and commissioning would only be in 2017. Now, compared to the original estimate in the end of 2013, there was a huge difference. It's beyond my expectation. That's why I was surprised. And then on the same day, the THB officials and Highways Department received a call from MTRCL as well. They were also surprised by this piece of information. So the government asked the MTRCL to take all possible measures to try to reduce the delay and keep costs within the budget. Now, on the responsibilities of the MTRCL under the entrustment agreement, we will consult the Secretary for Justice to make sure we protect the interests of taxpayers. Now, on whether THB has been too trusting in the MTRCL, I agree, in terms of judgment and assessment, there was a problem. At that time, the differences between the administration and the MTRCL should have been made public, and this should have been reported to the LegCo. For this, I am responsible, and I offer a solemn apology to the Legislative Council and the public, and I accept any criticisms from the public. Now, looking forward, we must learn from our lessons. We must avoid recurrence of similar mistakes. So the government is going to set up an independent experts panel, including overseas experts, on the management of the MTRCL and on the monitoring mechanism about these projects of the MTRC, the interfacing issues and so on. There will be a complete review. We will see whether there are any existing problems and the causes for these problems, the gravity of these problems, and they will give their observations and make recommendations for improvement. The panel will submit a report to the chief executive. The report will be made public. The administration is fully aware of the public concern about the delays in the XRL project and the management issues exposed by these delays in the MTRCL. And many the people now doubt the performance of the MTRCL. Now, MTRCL carries some 5 million passengers a day, so their management is of great importance to the public. The MTRCL is also building 5 different new lines, so it's important that these projects are completed on schedule and within budget. This is what the public expects. The administration is the monitoring authority of railway services. We also the majority shareholder of the MTRCL, so we're duty bound to monitor the work of the MTRCL. We must fulfill our duties as the majority shareholder to see if there's a need to reform the management of the MTRCL. We won't let the public down. Thank you. Thank you, Secretary, for saving 1.5 minutes for us. Next term, MTRCL.
Chairman, members, first of all, I thank the subcommittee for arranging this meeting so that we have the opportunity to give a full account of the progress of the XRL. The XRL is an important project for Hong Kong, and we face various challenges, and they pose impact on the completion date. In relation to this, we did not give a full account to the public. On behalf of the MTR, I express my deepest apology. We are aware of the public's keen concern about the XRL project, and they have raised a lot of questions. Mr. Walder and my colleagues will explain the reasons behind the project delay, the lessons learned, as well as the mitigation measures implemented by the management. Our project team has also laid out a realistic plan for opening target in 2017. I wish to emphasize that the team at MTR, together with the contractors, have worked relentlessly and diligently to tackle the challenges, and they have achieved considerable progress. We must acknowledge, however, that when it comes to the communications about the MTR XRL progress, it's not ideal, and we apologize. The board has put in place a number of measures, and it has taken this seriously. These measures include a committee comprising independent non-executive directors was responsible for reviewing the management of the XRL project and for making recommendations to ensure that the project's team, the management and the board can effectively monitor the project and to achieve the project completion date of 2017. The corporation has announced that in a spirit of full openness and transparency, a central data room will be set up specifically for legislators to access the corporation's external and internal documents relating to the XRL project. The data room is expected to be ready in June 2014, and it will remain open until the completion of the project. Documents will be updated on a regular basis. Last but not least, I'd like to say that there are professionals in our team and tens of thousands of construction crew members. No matter what the challenges are and what the weather is like, they toil every day, day in and day out, to tackle these challenges for the XRL project. However, we fail in public communication, and it has caused public outcry. And as a result, there, our hard work has not been duly recognized. I do feel very sorry about this. And I would like to say that our crew members, contractors, and everyone in the corporation will keep in mind the completion date and give Hong Kong a very good infrastructure. Next. Mr. Walder.
First, I want to apologize. We did not do a good job in communicating with you or with the public about XRL. There are no excuses. We understand our responsibilities for this public project, and we let you down. We should have been clearer, not only about the challenges, but also about the considerable progress that has been made. For this meeting, we have submitted to you a full and honest account of all events that took place up to April 15th, the day that we announced that due to the insurmountable challenges, the Express Rail Link opening date, regrettably, had to be changed to 2017. Equally important, our report puts forth a clear plan to take this project forward for operation in 2017. It's realistic and it is achievable. It's a plan that all of us at MTR and our contractors stand behind. Members have asked why we didn't tell you earlier about the implications of the delays we were experiencing. In hindsight, that's what we should have done. Our belief is that all efforts should be made to address problems with the construction project before accepting that it will be delayed. I must say that I have worked in the rail industry for many years, and I have worked with many, many dedicated people. But I have never seen the strength of commitment and conviction that I see here at MTR to deliver projects on time and to budget. And it was in this spirit that we approached government with a plan to provide the full passenger service and essential facilities in 2015, allowing time after passenger services had started to complete the non-essential features of the project. While they had their doubts, I have to thank the Secretary and his team for giving us the time to try to do it. We tried hard. We explored every possible solution and every possible alternative to achieve this deadline. Unfortunately, the obstacles were just too great, and it became clear in my meeting with the team in April that 2015 was simply out of reach. Our imperative then was to tell everyone as soon as possible, and I immediately called the MTR chairman and the Secretary for Transport and Housing. We didn't want to let the public down, and regrettably it led us to wait too long in communicating. As CEO, I take responsibility for that in the same way that I take responsibility for everything that happens in the corporation. But I don't think that this should take away from the good work that the team has done. From the very beginning, XRL has presented serious challenges. Delayed site access, difficult ground conditions, deformed piles, and bad weather have all cost us time, in some cases, well over a year. Instead of using these challenges as excuses to accept delays, we brought in additional resources, we tried new methods, we adjusted designs, we resequenced work. I know that today is about understanding what happened. I sit here with my colleagues ready to answer all of your questions, openly, honestly, and humbly. But I also hope that we can look forward to the way we are going to continue to build this railway. I assure you that every one of us is committed to the project. We know that it will not be easy, but we're confident that we can continue to overcome the challenges to deliver this important new infrastructure for Hong Kong. And we will do so in a spirit of unprecedented openness and transparency, including more substantive reporting directly to this committee. Thank you very much.
Next.
Members, I will speak in English as I don't speak Cantonese well, and thank you for your kind understanding. I am very sorry to cause such a lot of problem for everybody due to my late communication and misjudgment about the XRL project program. Kindly accept my sincere apology. FGA have said, the high-speed rail project has experienced difficult challenges from day one, challenges that impact the program. It did not stop us from identifying solutions to overcome these challenges and make up for lost time. We continue to apply the MTR's best project management approach throughout the project, in the same way as we have done across all our projects. Lately, I have been doing a lot of reflection. Why didn't I say something sooner? I had a number of opportunities to flag the difficulties and the issue upward. In particular, at the review meetings that took place last October, last December, and just in March. But I didn't say anything, not to the CEO, not to the board, not to the government, member of this council, and the public. I can only say it was because I strongly believed in our ability to recover the delays of the program and open in 2015. I take full responsibility for this, and I sincerely apologize from the bottom of my heart that I've created the wrong impression and hurt the credibility of MTR. This is my failure. I hope it does not take away your faith in MTR team and the board to able take this project forward in a timely manner. Thank you, Chairman and Legislative Member. Antonio.
You, Jay.
Members, Chairman, the SIR project is very complicated and is very challenging. At the start of the project, there are a number of challenges. The team has been exploring feasible solutions, mitigating measures to achieve the completion date. And as a matter of fact, a number of them have been effective to make up for lost time. You'll find the information in the document. Despite our endeavors, there are three crucial critical areas in the project that has caused delay. And I will give you the information. As you see, that the majority of the progress of tunneling work has been satisfactory. However, for AO10A, WK terminus northern side and contract number A23, the section that is submerged in the flooding, and the tunneling section of A26, they are all critical elements, and they have experienced delay, and as a result we have to revise the completion date.
First, for the West Kowloon terminus WKT, this is a project of great concern to the public. Since the start of works at the WKT, we have faced immense challenges and delay. It's also affected the progress of the project. As you can see, to the left we have Jordan Road, to the right Austin Road. First, we have to build the underground diaphragm wall before we could start the projects. For H11B, when we constructed the diaphragm wall along Jordan Road, there was unforeseen ground condition, like uneven rock level, boulders, presence of boulders, and uncharted public utilities, there was delay to the project. And there was consequential delay to 810A for the start time of the entry to the project site for 810A suffered delay. And then 810B here to the right, excavation was completed by 99%. EMM's works have started some time ago. It's only in to the north. For some, the excavations reached level B4. Last week, members visited the site. You were standing here to the north of the terminus. And you can see on site that for some construction works, they started from B4 all the way up to the ground level. As for the Jordan station to the north, now we've excavated down to B1 and B2. Now we had to go down to B4, and that means we have to excavate about 70 to 80,000 known hard rock. To catch up with the delay, we have already implemented a series of recovery measures, but still we could not recover the progress. Nonetheless, we have come up with some proposals and to complete the works for this West Kowloon terminus in 2016, so service could commence in 2017. Now, for the measures we've mentioned, they would make sure that service could start in 2017, but we want to be prudent, so we are considering further measures at the moment. That is closing a section of Lin Chen Road and adoption of drill and blast method. We are now considering the details, and we will be applying to the government departments and consulting local residents. Contract 823A, that poses immense challenge. There was delay in land resumption for Choi Yun village and also in excavation, so we've added an additional tunnel boring machine to recover progress. But because of the three constant changes in the rock ground condition, there was often need for major repair of the TBM. And of course, because of flooding, the TBM broke down. And we expect that by 2016 February, we could complete the tunneling works here. Another major challenge is the cross-boundary tunnel section. That's the mainland section and the Hong Kong section for this cross-boundary tunnel. Now, for the Shenzhen section, they encountered a lot of difficulties during the work. Though the second TBM only arrived in Hong Kong in March this year, later than the original schedule. And then we are drilling along where there are caverns, so we have to proceed most cautiously. By May 2015, we should be able to complete the tunneling works. Mr. Choi, please be quick. You've exceeded the time limit. So we have reviewed the three critical contracts. We've also reviewed other projects. We have now come up with a revised program because the tunnel must be fully completed before we could start testing. So that's why tunneling was important for the overall progress of the project. Now, we are confident that by the fourth quarter of 2016, we should be able to complete all the tunneling works. And then for the West Kowloon terminus works, the structure could be completed by the end of 2016. Dynamic testing could start from February 2017, and then revenue service could start in 2017. Now, we have a contingency amount of $5.4 billion, we still have $3.7 billion in the contingency reserve. We are doing new estimates on the extra cost caused by the delay. That shouldn't be too far off the figure reported by the media. That's $64.4 billion, but still we will keep a close eye on progress and costs for the project. Thank you. So there's 80 minutes to 6:30. 10 minutes have indicated a wish to speak. Gary Fang, Elizabeth Kwok, Ben Chen, Kwok Ka Kee, Claudia Mo, Michael Tam, Helena Wong, Tang Ka, Bill, Regina Yip, and others. Who else, please? Felix Chung. Yu Yong, raise your hand.
we each would have 5 minutes, but now there are 17 members asking to speak 5 minutes each. That means 85 minutes. That means we may have to extend the meeting by another 15 minutes. But I'm sure members would like to have 5 minutes each, right? So there won't be a second round. Mr. Frankie Yick has also put up his hand. No, sorry. I think we have to go back to 4 minutes now. 18 times 4, 72 minutes. Definitely some will overrun and because we only have 80 minutes. So 4 minutes each then. Mr. Gary Fang. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just now, Dr. Raymond Chiang and Mr. J. Walder, including the Secretary, stressed this is a question of communication, but I think it's more than about communication. It's about the MTRCL. You know, it's a listed company with capitalization of $150 billion. It's about the integrity and credibility of listed company. It's about mismanagement. It's about poor professional judgment. So just a word of apology is not enough. Hong Kong people know full well, Mr. Chairman. This project costing over $60 billion, some dub it the white elephant. Now, this is the most expensive railway project in Hong Kong. It's the biggest railway project as well in Hong Kong in our history. If there's delay in the project, there will be far-reaching implications and a lot of public money will be spent because there will be cost overrun. But then the MTRCL hasn't done its job properly. It hasn't done proper professional judgment, its investigation is not done properly, its management is not done properly, its cost delay, its cost overrun. But what's the cost and public outcry is that, and what's enraged this council is that when they're not able to cover up the truth anymore, they, you know, it was exposed by the media, or they try to deny that. They try to cover up. They still try to pass on the blame. They try to blame it on black rainstorm, on ground condition, and you know, the flooding of the TBM. And when professionals then try to put things right, then you still try to then only then you admitted to it. And then actually, as far back as last April, there was paper within the MTRCL indicating there could be delay. And then also in the media, Ming Pao and Apple Daily, in May 2013, there were reports that there was possible delay. But then last November, the Secretary received a call from Mr. Jade Walder. Originally, the Project Supervision Committee led by the Highways Department or the Director of Highways decided to give an account to the Subcommittee on Railways at this of this council. But then the Secretary took what Mr. Jade Walder said and decided to cover up and to hide the truth from the public. Now, this is unacceptable. Here, this is about the personal integrity of a principal official. And I would say an apology is not enough. Here, I would ask Mr. Jade Walder this. When are you going to resign and take blame for or take responsibility for the delay in the express rail link? And Secretary, I also want to ask you, you know, an apology is not enough. How are you going to take responsibility? How are you going to be accountable? Now, there will be a three-member independent expert panel. Have you considered restructuring the board of directors of the MTRCL? Have you considered replacing the chairman of the board of the directors of MTRCL so that MTRCL will no longer operate as an independent kingdom? And Professor Anthony Jung, in the whole paper, there's no mention of this. When did Leung Chan Ying, the chief executive, learn about the XRL delay? And when MTRCL reported the XRL delay to you, how did you report it to the chief executive and the executive council? And what did the CE and the executive council give you by way of instructions? And then this three-member independent expert panel that you announced last week, and then Professor Lee Chek Fan resigned in a matter of 2 hours. So when did you, so who appointed him? Now you only give 15 seconds to the administration to answer. I'll be very strict. Who's to answer first? Now let me clarify. On the 12th of April, I received a call from Mr. J. Walder. On Monday, I informed the chief executive about the delay of the XRL, about appointing Professor Lee Chak Fun to the independent expert panel, I extended the invitation. But of course, we did not make formal appointment because we had to wait for other candidates. And then they would be appointed by the chief executive. Dr. Elizabeth Quart. Now, having heard the explanation today, I'm even more shocked than the secretary, and I'm angry as well. Well, I don't suppose anyone will tell us whether you colluded to cover up the whole case. But what I'd like to find out is this. When Mr. J. Walder called the secretary in November, can you tell us on what basis did you decide that you would not announce the matter? And well, based on what reasons did you believe that you could still achieve the original target? And secretary, now, on what basis did you decide that you believed that there was no need to tell Lechko at his meeting in November what happened? And again, on what reasons did you think that the target could still be achieved? From November to now, April, all this time, Mr. J. Walder never came out to meet the public to give an account. People felt he was trying to shirk responsibility. Now, MTR was the pride of Hong Kong. But apart from this case, you know, we have seen many incidents involving MTR, signaling problems, poor contingency measures, and even for Sha Tin Central Line, there are problems as well. So can I ask the chairman of the MTRCL, do you believe Mr. J. Walder is still competent enough to manage MTRCL? Do you think he should resign and take responsibility for this? Now, secretary, you mentioned the independent ad hoc task force. Is that the only way to monitor MTRCL as the majority shareholder? Are there other ways to better manage the MTRCL? Dr. Elizabeth Quart, you asked so many questions I couldn't jot them all down. Who's going to go first? Secretary? Okay.
Our first answer, Ms. Quart's last point. In my opening speech, I said that we will step up our monitoring and supervision of the MTRCL. And as I said that the government is the major shareholder of the MTRCL, so we will fulfill our responsibility. And I've also said that we will review the operation of the MTRCL, and we will give you the details later. In relation to the whole matter, that is, on the 21st of November last year, well, on the 20th of November, I decided to give an account on the 22nd of November to the subcommittee that there is a possibility of a delay, and later I changed my version. I would defer to Mr. Lai, Joseph Lai, about a meeting with the MTRCL in the evening on the 21st of November. Mr. Lai, perhaps I will be given more time to tell you what transpired in the meeting on the 21st of November. We don't have much time, so please be brief. I'll do that as far as I can. As set out in the document, in the meeting, I and my colleagues doubted repeatedly the possibility of commissioning of the SRL by the end of 2015. And that was based on the information we have of the progress. If the project cannot meet target, and even the terminus is completed on time, then there won't be any commission of service. However, the MTRCL was confident that the whole service will be commissioned in 2015. And according to the information supplied to the administration and the highways department, given the progress, the commissioning date in 2015 might be affected. Well, please don't repeat what is already set out in the paragraph 45. Give some time for the MTRCL to answer, but your time has used up. There are 18 people waiting to speak. If we can't finish, you have to wait till the 19th of May. Next, Mr. Chen Han Pen. I declare that I'm a small shareholder of the MTRCL. Secretary, you said that you gave them the benefit of the doubt. Is it the case that you're too merciful, and as a result, you now regret it? In this matter, we see that the MTRCL has been covering up time and again. And where there are minor setbacks, I know that is common. But when it comes to cover up time and again, for everything, I think it is rather serious. I have three questions for the administration and the MTRCL. First, I'd like to know, there has been cumulative delays, and the MTRCL is receiving $4.6 billion as management project management cost. There is now a serious delay. Would the administration withhold the $4.6 billion? And the second question is for the MTRCL. Now we have a serious delay. The original date is 2015 and now it's revised to 2017 for commissioning. This is a serious delay. Should the MTRCL take responsibility? There will be extra costs as a result of the delay. Will it be taken up by the MTRCL? On the books, it says there is an cost overrun of $2 billion, and I don't know how much more it will be. Every year, the MTRCL is making over $10 billion money, $10 billion from Hong Kong. Third question for Mr. Walder. You have tried different ways to cover this up, and you have put the secretary in a difficult position. So do you have a problem with your integrity? This is a huge enterprise. And this is about an office, an officer in charge of a huge enterprise. If there are integrity issues, it's difficult for us to have confidence in the enterprise. Mr. Walder, would you resign taking responsibility? These are my questions. First, Secretary, would you withhold that management cost? Now that we have a delay, and according to the entrustment agreement and other legal considerations, when it comes to fees and costs, and how the administration sees the responsibility of the MTRCL, well, we will have to wait for the details of the comprehensive assessment, and on top of that, we will seek legal advice from the DOJ. MTR, would you take responsibility and shoulder the cost overrun? Who is to take the question, Mr. Walder?
Members, I want to assure you that we treat all project costs of this project very, very seriously, and we are committed to ensuring that public funds are used in a responsible, efficient manner. The project has encountered a number of difficulties, site access delays, unforeseen conditions, difficulties with piles that were driven in too far, difficulties with piles that were not on maps, etc. In fact, I have to say, having reviewed the history of the project going back to 2010, that I am struck by how much has been done to try to be able to keep this project on schedule throughout the entire time. I will confirm to the chamber that we do recognize our obligations under the entrustment agreement, and we will stand by those obligations.
I don't want to hear that. I just want to see if you will be take responsibility and whether you will resign. My time is running out. It's a waste of time.
You will bear the cost overrun if it's within the contractual obligation, correct?
I said we will stand by the obligations in the entrustment agreement, yes.
Okay. Do you admit or agree that there's an integrity issue on your part? And that what you plan to do?
I do not. I have apologized for the confusion and the misunderstanding that we've caused by not keeping members in the community informed of the delays. I do believe that this has been a very complex project. I don't think that the question has been the project management and the management of MTR toward the project. I believe the challenge in front of us and the challenge behind us has been we have not communicated well and we have made bad decisions in our communication strategy.
All right, thank you.
Dr. Kwakaki. This is a tragedy for Hong Kong. Those who are sitting there, they enjoyed millions or tens of millions of dollars of their salary. Hong Kong government holds 77% of the shareholders, and they allow the MTRCL to coach them to tell lies. Everyone is lied to. The CEO lied, the project director lied, and you listen to them. And you misled the LegCo, and now we have this mess. And these as independent expert, that is also involved in with interest. And back in 2009, you were the chairman, Mr. Chen. Well, did you see the difficulties? Did you have any, were you put in a difficult position? Did you know? And in November, when your subordinate, Mr. Walder, called the secretary, did you know or not? And the second question is for the secretary, Mr. Zheng. Now, this is a complete mess on the part of the MTRCL. I don't know who will believe or trust them. Safety, whether something can be done, whether the rock is too hard. They should not be believed. You said you have engaged an overseas expert for a review. I don't know when the review will be completed. But if you ask Hong Kong people to continue to believe this group of people who are taking hundreds of millions of dollars from Hong Kong, and you ask us to believe the MTRCL board, it's not just the XRL. There is a Shatin Central line, the SR, the South Island line. Every day we see a spate of incidents. Well, now we think that the board and the management should be held accountable. So I asked you, when will you change the board? My third question, under the entrustment agreement, you said in a very certain way that they will be bear the cost overrun. Have you asked for legal advice? Don't be happy too early, because even if that is the case, that they are using our money to pay, because the Hong Kong government holds 77% of the shares. Mr. Chen, did the administration force you to do anything? Back in November, did you know or not? Well, I already said that we will set up a central data room which will make available all the documents. So you cannot remember whether you were forced, because it's been 4 years? I cannot recall if the administration has put pressure on us to do what, because they adopt an at arm's length relationship. And this entrustment agreement is a result of negotiation. Second question, when Walder called the secretary, did you know or not? No, I did not. Not at all. Thank you. Secretary, I would like to clarify, I did not lie. On the 21st of November, there was a meeting in the evening. The Highways Department, the THB, had a discussion with the MTRCL. We learned about the situation, and it was based on this understanding that we reported to the subcommittee. Just now, it was mentioned about the independent expert committee involving an overseas member. It was not on the governance structure of the MTRCL. It's about this delay. Okay, I don't have time. About the management, we don't have faith in them anymore. You hold 77% of the share. What are you going to do? Well, as I said, that this is not my personal view. This is the view of the government. We will perform our duty as the major shareholder. We will urge the administration to put in place improvement measures. When will it be done? We will announce the details later. Ms. Claudia Mo. The MTRCL is the government. The government is the MTRCL. The government holds over 2/3 of the shares. So is it the case that they're colluding with one another? I don't think we'll be able to get to the bottom of this. But it's my impression that the administration just blame everything on the management of the MTR, saying that there is poor governance so the administration can stay in a safe place. Secretary, you're an educationist. Well, I did not expect that you'd be one day a secretary for transport. And this is a scandal, and this has cast doubt on your integrity. Some members already proposed to move a motion of no confidence on you. And today, I am inclined to support this motion of no confidence. My first question, Secretary, would you consider resign on your own initiative? Second question.
Walder, do you actually feel that you're being made a political scapegoat of sorts in this scandal? There's this Ming Pao exclusive, supposedly, today, that you're supposed to know, you should have known that about the granite condition at the terminus, because that report, all those documents could date back way back to 1997. You should have known. Is that true? And my question number three, will you actually consider quitting, being blamed practically for everything? Apparently, you managed to stop the bureau chief, to be honest with this chamber. But you're not his boss, right? Were you not being made a political scapegoat? Thank you.
局長,
主席, 這件事,
Secretary, Mr. Chairman, this case may lead you to believe that there may be some sort of collusion between the government and TRCL. That's why some has doubt questions the integrity of the government or my integrity. I feel sorry about that. Well, they're friends who know me. They've asked how come this happened. In my own political career, you know, I was involved in political activities before, and now I know that in a political life, we often face challenges. Sometimes we have to make decisions, and I keep reflecting on that.
Scapegoat, will you resign?
I can tell the chamber that, as has been referred, on the 21st of November, there were conversations that took place between myself, the secretary, and later that evening with the staff of THB. It was my belief, on the basis of the information that had been provided to me, that we had a viable plan for the initiation of passenger service in 2015. And I communicated that.
Yes, we all knew about the background. Please, could you just answer the question? Are you being victimized in your own opinion?
I am accountable for MTR. I'm responsible for MTR, and I accept that responsibility. As I've said to the chamber, I do believe that we have had a failure to communicate openly, candidly, effectively with government, with our board, with this chamber. I accept that responsibility in doing that. With all humility, I really believe that the issue for me right now is about how to take this forward and about how to be able to put forth the plan that we have laid out to you and Antonio has put forth here today to show you that we can deliver the XRL project from this point forward, taking account of what we know, everything that we know, and bringing the best of MTR's project management to the table.
Next is my turn. On the 21st of November, Secretary, there was an emergency meeting between MTRCL and the government that evening. The MTRCL maintained that there were still the conditions for the service to be commissioned in 2015, but then it would be a one-track proposal, single-track proposal across Chenzhen River, but you did not accept that approach. And then the following day, you gave an undertaking at LegCo. That is and I assume that there would be two tunnels going across Shenzhen River. But was there any consensus with the MTRCL when that meeting ended? Well, perhaps Mr. Joseph Lai could explain because he was at the meeting. Was there such a consensus? Well, I could tell you specifically that we did not accept the one-track proposal. And at that meeting, I conveyed that message clearly to the MTRCL. So the following day, you gave this commitment, and the MTRCL was aware of it, and it supported the undertaking, right? And then you said you were clear that the consensus was that there would be two-track, two tunnels, right? Fine. Okay, Mr. Chu Tai Chong, do you agree there was this consensus at the end of that meeting? That evening?
At the meeting with the THB on 21st November.
Can you please be brief and to the point?
Yep. Yeah.
Please spare me the preamble. We
approach the completion is based on the six platform and double track base.
I'm asking you about the Shenzhen River crossing.
Yes.
Single tunnel or double tunnel?
It is double tunnel, and then the single tunnel was put forward as a fallback. And then when during the 22nd November LegCo meeting, when it was indicated that we will complete the work by 2015, followed by 6 to 9 months of testing and commissioning.
Your understanding is a double tunnel.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then let me ask you. At the beginning of that meeting, it's quoted that MPR claimed the single tunnel is possible. So in one session, you went from a single tunnel being possible to a double tunnel also being possible. Now you realize that depends on the China side. What gives you the confidence you can control the China side?
Chairman, when you look at the up track, which is the one that has raised concern by THB, we believe that we can make recovery on that.
So you made a promise or a pledge within the same session based on external circumstances that you cannot control. Because you came in the meeting with a one tunnel version that's being possible, correct?
No, sir. We came to THP with two track and offer an alternative backup system.
Okay, that's not
track,
okay.
Sir.
Anyway, that's not what the document said. My second question is, in the document on 22nd to Lechko, you said that on the northern part of the station, you've gone to B4, all right? Now, in the latest document, that section will not be completed until 2016. That's December, that's 2 years later. I just want to ask you, when you make that pledge in November last year, what was your rock excavation rate at that time, and what was the target rate you need to achieve to fulfill that pledge?
Chairman, as this is very specific, can I ask my colleague to give
you
the answer?
You cannot remember now? This is the single most critical point that your pledge is based on.
My pledge at that time is double the current production rate as indicated in the program.
Okay, double the rate.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you made your pledge based on doubling the rate.
Correct, sir.
And you have failed.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Next, Mr. Li Chat-Yan. Well, having heard the discussion so far, the whole MTRCL is still maintaining stiff upper lips, and it's a fake apology. It's not a sincere apology. Actually, they're still being very arrogant in facing the people of Hong Kong. And they keep saying that they haven't lied to anybody. I think that's totally not true. From the beginning, MTRC has been lying to us. But still, they're not trying to take responsibility. That's their attitude. Why do I say that you are lying all along? If you read the MTRC's report and the administration's report, both reports are before us. In the MTRCL's report in June 2013, they already said that they asked the contractor to consider a partial opening approach. That's June 2013. Already then they mentioned it. And then in the administration's report, in September, the 13th of September 2013, the administration was informed by MTRCL that it was considering a partial opening approach. That means between June and September 2013. So that means throughout 2013, they knew the 2015 target couldn't be achieved. They were still talking about partial opening. And then the administration told us in their paper that you did not agree to the option of partial opening. And this was all known in 2013. And then by the 21st of November 2013, Jay Walder called Anthony Jeong. Anthony Jeong said that you did not lie. But then the problem was he taught you to lie. And he taught you to lie how? He said that by 2015, the service could still be commissioned. But you knew earlier than that there would just be a partial opening. Would you agree to that? Would you confess to that, admit to that? That is, all along it was just partial opening, and though you did not agree to it, right? So you did not agree to partial opening, and he was talking about partial opening all along, so you knew 2015 wouldn't be realistic. He taught you to lie. How come you agreed then to lie? And how, after the emergency meeting, then it was agreed that this will not be told to the Lechko. So is it the fact that Jay Walder taught you to lie, and then he, of course, he's the main culprit, he taught you to lie? Raymond Chen, I think, should dismiss him. I asked Raymond Chen whether he would dismiss him. And then he taught you to lie, but at the end you agreed to lie. So does it mean that that was a complete failure in your judgment? Because you said all along you did not accept the partial opening approach. How come you said you did not did lie? Now, Mr. Li Chao-yuan, let's get the details right. The administration has never given its position on partial opening. It's only opposed to the extended partial opening option. Let you clarify. Thank you for that. Yes, that's all along been our position. I need some time, please. In September 2013, the MTRCL proposed the partial commissioning approach to the administration. That means at the West Kowloon terminus originally, there would be 15 platforms, but when service starts, there would just be 6 platforms. And the 6 platforms could still provide all the scheduled train services. So that's our understanding of the partial opening approach. And on this proposal, we never agreed or disagreed to it, because at that time, our biggest concern was whether there were just 6 platforms in WKT, but rather it's about the tunneling works. And by the 21st of November, Mr. Cho proposed this backup option, that is single track two-way, and we made it clear that we would not accept that proposal. Well, okay, so you said you did not accept it. How come then you turn around and tell us the commission is still possible in 2013? So, because every month in the report, it say that we delay. Mr. Lee, you've used up your time. Next, Mr. James Toh. Mr. Chairman, first of all, I asked the administration and the MTRCL to give us the minutes of the emergency meeting on the 21st of November. Give it to us in the next few days, please. I'm sure you have the minutes. Second point, what I don't get is that in paragraph 43, the administration said that it was aware that it should tell the Subcommittee on Railways that there's a possibility of a service commissioning only after 2014-15, that's the real possibility. How come after this call to the Secretary, then you came and explained to us that the project could be completed? Now, you didn't believe the project could be completed yourself by then. You should have at least said that the MTRCL insisted the project could be completed, but the administration had reservation, or you did not buy that. Why didn't you dare to say so, Secretary? If you wouldn't even say so, or if the Undersecretary didn't say so then, that means it's a cover-up. How come you didn't say that? If you had said so, is it then, it would be as what the MTRCL said, they couldn't put pressure on contractors to catch up the delay. But it doesn't matter, it's just the MTRCL's assessment. Have you ever considered this option? Or after consideration, did you then choose to say that you just wanted to tell Hong Kong people that it's possible by 2015? If that's the case, then it's cover up. Well, in his opening remarks, the Secretary owned up to that, to this point. I want the Secretary to answer me. Has he ever thought about that? Yeah, Mr. Toh is right. Originally, I had 2 choices. One, was what happened. That is, I told people the construction works could be completed in 2015 and 6 to 9 months of testing and trial running and then commissioning. Or the other option is that I could lay bare the differences between the MTRCL and the administration. I could have told that to the LegCo. I already admitted to the point in my opening remarks that, yes, looking back, I could have done that. It would be much easier. It's not the case because I was put under pressure by Mr. J. Walder, so I changed my position. No, it's not like that. But rather, I did not... Yes, there is this possibility of commissioning after 2015, but then Mr. J. Walder said there was the possibility of the delay being caught up with. So that's why I said that we had to put on the table all the details and we must review the whole case again, and that involves a professional judgment. Now, Mr. Joseph Lai wanted a chance to tell you what the considerations were, then I hope you will give him the opportunity to do so. But paragraph 46, it says here, when you came to meeting, the Undersecretary said, could, used could, You just quoted from the MTRCL to say it could be completed. So that means the administration agreed to that assessment. You know, that has to be the case. Well, Mr. Chairman, of course, in terms of works, about 2 days ago when I met with the media, I'd set this, the scenarios. You know, there were different assessments on the scenarios between the two parties. The critical project is the contract 826, that is a cross-boundary tunnel, when they could reach this side, the Hong Kong side. And MTR said that once the TBM reached the Hong Kong side, then they were confident that they could catch up with the delay. So it's about when it could get to WKTD. So does it mean that you have changed your judgment? You've been convinced and it's a different story, but you're saying that you weren't convinced, but still you told their line. That means it's a lie. No, it's not a lie, Mr. Chairman. You could say at that point, how come at that point we did not come to a judgment call? Why didn't we make the judgment call that, yes, I admit, with hindsight, that's caused all these doubt as to whether there was a cover-up on the part of the government. But at that time, we were all acting in good faith.
Mr. Lo Wai Kok, in the administration's report in Annex G, there is a chronology. Every month, in relation to the meeting of the Project Supervision Committee and the MTRCL, the information of the meetings were set out, and there is also a comparison of progress, actual progress and scheduled progress. We see that the gap is getting bigger and bigger. So I would like to know, in the face of that, what were the considerations? Is it just a matter of faith or trust? What measures have been put in place to make sure that these recovery measures are effective? In the middle of last year, the MTRCL proposed the partial opening scenario. It showed that there was some time lag that was not really recoverable. So what were the considerations back then? And I think that now it's important to see if these mitigation measures are effective. In relation to the diaphragm wall, in relation to the terminus, people are very concerned about the rock formation. But there is also the crucial delay of the peripheral wall. Another important point is the tunnel boring machine, TBM. And it says that it would only be at the end of this year when they can repair the TBM. And without that, there won't be track work done. So would there be a guarantee that there will be commissioning of service in 2017? I'd like some answers. Director for Highways. Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for the question. Mr. Low pointed out the progress in the report, and there is a gap between the actual overall progress and the programmed schedule. I would like to say that we do not rely only on one indicator, because every indicator has a weak point. It's just like the one mentioned just now. The program schedule of the MTRCL is calculated based on the original work schedule, and it was not amended as a result of amendments to various contracts. And apart from that, we also take into account the overall utilization of contracts and the various delays. And they all, taken together, reflect the overall progress. So we have to look at the critical, the lag in critical work and the progress of recovery. Let me give you an example. In 4.4.4, in October 2013, under the 810A, there is a delay of 10 weeks, that is the WK terminus. We urged the MTRCL to introduce more mitigation measures to catch up the lag of 10 weeks. And in relation to infrastructural work of Hong Kong, there has been a lot of recovery done. Say, for example, the Shenzhen Bay Bridge. It's completed on schedule. And at about 70% of work progress, they haven't used 50% of the project cost. So the progress is actually similar to this project. Another example is the Hong Kong Convention and Exhibition Hall. And it was completed in 1997. Towards the end, thousands of workers were working at the construction site. So as to whether they can catch up, it depends also on the injection of resources. Mr. Chen Kam-lam. Paragraph 45, it says that on the 21st of November 2013, the MTRCL emphasized that it was imperative that the target of 2015 be adhered to. Otherwise, they would not be able to press the contractors to push forth the project. We see some grounds in this reason. But what we would like to know is that afterwards, what did the MTRCL do to exert pressure on the contractors, and what are the results? In less than a month, they told the administration that that couldn't be done, and it could only be commissioned at the end of 2016. Why was there such a huge change? MTRCL, who is to take the question? Mr. Choi? Mr. Chu? And Mr. Choi? At the northern section, there was some problem with rock formation, so there was a delay. Next to Jordan Road, we resequenced the works. There were a number of critical plant rooms that should be completed before work starts. So we resequenced the works. As a result, we could work on the slab first. Then E&M contractors could work at the same time. Under the original plan, it started bottom up. And at the eastern section, the question was, what did you do to pressure the contractors? Because after a month, everything different. What happened? No, it's not about exerting pressure. We work together with the contractors on mitigation measures to speed up the process so that the different works can go in tandem to ensure that the critical plant rooms can operate and serve as the signaling system when the tunneling works completed. So how come that, if things did not work out? But it's my time. I should be the one asking follow-up questions. Okay, you go ahead. Oh, we are both very concerned about this matter. I just want to know what they have actually done. They told the administration that they would put pressure on the contractors, and now that they said that it's not about exerting pressure, it's to discuss with them. But we're very concerned about the result. Well, you may have spoken to them. You come up with two options. One is blasting. When did you propose the option of blasting to the administration, and what answer did they give you? Is it an agreement? When it comes to blasting, it's a common practice in other works project in Hong Kong. You want an answer or not? Yes, I want to know about what happened. Mr. Choi. Blasting is one of the options. We looked at the situation. What's most critical are the plant rooms. The rock formation is a known fact. There are about 70,000 cubic meters of rock formation. The answer wasn't clear. When did they make the proposal of blasting to the administration? You will have to wait till the 19th. Ms. Lena Wong. The Democratic Party asked to invoke the LCPNP ordinance to find to the bottom of the matter, because we see a lot of doubts First, about the chronology. Originally, back in 2010, it was said that the service will be commissioned in August 2015. However, in June 2013, in some internal documents of the MTRCL, it was made known that it could not be done. And it was said that at the end of 2015, it could only be partial opening. And in November 2013, the MTRCL started telling the administration that end of 2015 could not see partial opening. It could only be a partial testing and trial run. You will have to wait September 2016 for full commissioning. However, in paragraph 44, it says that the CEO of MTRCL, that is Mr. J. Wolder, told the secretary, expressing disagreement with reporting to the subcommittee, that the target for commencing operation in 2015 could not be met. And he stressed that he stuck to the original operation date. How come? And Mr. Yao Xingmu, in November 2013, said to the subcommittee that in 2015, the project could be completed. Perhaps he has heard of what the CEO said. And Mr. Yao said that they would need 6 to 9 months for trial run and testing. Is it the case that you helped the CEO to cover the whole thing up? The original date was August 2015. That was the original completion date. And then it's changed to partial opening. And then now it's a partial trial run and testing with an additional 6 to 9 months. Is it the case that you try to cover it up and then you find out it's too big for you to cover up? And 2016 may not be completion date because you have to test and try run, so it's the end of 2017. And you've been juggling between testing, partial, and this and that. Secretary, is it the case that you harbour the MTRCL about the delay? Do you regret it? If you turn back the clock, Mr. Secretary, would you adopt the same tactics? Perhaps we'll hear from the MTRCL first, yes or no. Mr. Wolder.
To clarify the plan that we spoke about on November 21st, what MTR was working toward was a plan that would meet the full operational service that was necessary on the first day. We believe that we could do that with 6 tracks as opposed to 15 tracks in the terminal, recognizing that the terminus was being built for the long-term capacity in Hong Kong, not for the opening day capacity. We would complete all of the essential works for that passenger service. There would be some non-essential works that would not be completed at that point in time. There was a continuing discussion with THB about the non-essential works that would be there. But we believe that we had a viable plan and we had a team who were quite enthusiastic about delivering that plan. On the day of the 21st, I checked with our projects director and our operations director. Why both? Because I needed to confirm not just that we could complete the facilities, but there was sufficient time to allow testing, commissioning, and safe operations of the railway. And that was the position that we went to THB with on the 21st of November.
Thank you, Wang Guohing.
Professor Zhang, did you regret what you did? Answered, but you've used up your time, Mr. Professor. As I said in my opening remarks, if I had known what I did could have caused so much doubt, of course, at the time I could have decided that we tell the differences between us. But what were the differences? The critical point was that for any railway project, you know, after completion of construction works, you know, for the terminus and the track and so on, there would be a need for a testing period, usually 3 months, and then there'll be trial running. So that's why we said after completion of works, another 6 to 9 months for testing and trial running. But then the difference was that for the THB, we believe that for the cross
boundary panelling works, we tended to be conservative. But then MTRCL believed they could catch up with the delay. So it depends on when they could catch up with the delay in 2015 and when the construction works could be completed, and that would have an impact on the ultimate commissioning date. So that's the difference. But it's not that there's any cover-up, it's just that we had differences in opinions. Mr. Wong Kwok Heng. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have two questions for the Secretary. Secretary, in your opening remarks and in your response just now, I can tell and I believe that you are not, teaming up with the MTRC on this. But then you gave the MTRC the benefit of the doubt, but then they tripped you up. They didn't. They are not thankful to what you did. So this is a big lesson you must have learned. And now, the mutual trust between the government and the MTRCL must have been severely undermined. There's no longer trust, actually. MTRCL is an independent kingdom, and under the circumstance, the MTRC said it would do a lot of mitigation measures to try to recover the progress, but there are still a lot of doubts remaining. So my first question for the Secretary is this. Secretary, in your opening remarks, you said you would consult the Secretary for Justice to see how you could protect public interest. Now, there's a management fee, project management fee of $4.9 billion to be paid to MTRCL. Would you consider that in terms of the management fee, you would deduct a certain amount, or you would actually withhold it from the MTRCL since the MTR has kept failing the public and the government, and it no longer has credibility? That's the first question. Second question, the mutual trust and cooperation must have been severely undermined. Now, MTR may have made a lot of undertakings, but how can we ensure they'll deliver? We can see that Mr. Chu Tai Chong has already tendered his resignation. So under the circumstance, would the administration consider resolute measures to take over completely all that the MTR is doing now? Because that's a complete overhaul. Would you consider taking over the MTR completely? Two questions there. Secretary? Under the entrustment agreement for the XRL project, now the MTR, whether it's got any responsibility in relation to the delay, what are the costs involved and so on, and the details and so on, as I mentioned in my opening remarks and also in the paper. Now, in the paper, we've explained the general arrangement under the entrustment agreement. Of course, I would have to seek the legal advice from the Secretary for Justice. I'm sure members are anxious to find out about it, but I'm the Secretary, so I have to think twice before I speak. On this case, that's why I won't just make casual comments. I must make sure there is proper legal advice. Second question, how do we ensure MTR will do a proper job in terms of projects and so on? Now, the administration is going to set up an independent expert panel to learn our lessons, in the whole process, in terms of the actual operations, where there are inadequacies, how we could address them. That's one thing. And another thing, of course, there are a lot of views in the community that the administration is the monitoring authority. We're also the majority shareholder, so we cannot shirk our responsibility. We will fulfill our obligations as the majority shareholder. We'll make sure that there'll be even better management in the MTRCL. That's something we are concerned about. Now, there's a mess now for this project. Will you take over completely? Your time is up. Next, Mr. Wu Chi-wai. A question for Professor Zheng. First one. Now, originally, commissioning is August 2015, but now 2017. But then eventually, it's just partial opening, and now it would just be six-track opening. How come you saw no need to explain such changes to the public? Now, the partial opening, partial trial running. Did you agree to that arrangement? If you did not, after you learned of that, what follow-up action was taken by the THB? Now, if we read the report, actually after November, until you expressed surprise, during those few months, we didn't see you giving any specific instructions and requiring the MTRCL to complete the works in accordance with the original entrustment agreement. So that's the first question. Second part of my question is for the Highways Department. There are five different levels to learn about the progress of the works in the Highways Department. There's the Contract Monitoring Committee, there's the Project Coordination Meeting, there's the Project Supervision Committee, there's the External Consultant, and then the CEDD also helped with monitoring and so on. Now, on the 20th of August 2013, before the MTRCL informed you about anything. Now, this partial opening approach, did they inform you about it? And when you learned about it, did you report to the THB? If so, when were you informed? And if you were informed, how come you didn't report to the THB? Another question for the Director of Highways. Now, in January 2013, you already asked the MTRC to give report on the overall progress. How come you allow them to complete the report only in August? Did you ever question them in between? Did you ever ask your external consultant to give you any assistance in the interim? Who would go first, director or secretary? I'll go first. I'll leave the second question to the director. On the 22nd of November last year, the Bureau gave a report to the Subcommittee on Railways. At the time, the way we put it was that within 2015, construction works will be completed and there will be an additional 6 to 9 months of testing and trial running. At that time, yes, the Bureau was being conservative. We were concerned that maybe the construction works will only be completed in the second half of 2015 and you add another 6 to 9 months, that means commissioning will be in 2016. But at the time, the MTRCL was a bit more optimistic. If we're just talking about the tunnelling works contracts, if the tunnelling works could be completed sooner, and then if there's a better coordination of testing and trial running, we still could not rule out the possibility that commissioning was possible at the end of 2015. So at the time, we gave the facts to the subcommittee. You might say afterwards, as we pursued MTRCL, did we do enough? At what point should we make a judgment call in confirming whether the deadline was still, the target was still realistic? As I said, with hindsight, perhaps there was inadequacy on our part, the way we handled this. Highways Director. Now, before August 2013, the first question was whether we knew about the partial opening option. The answer was no, we did not know about it. It was only until August or September 2013 when the MTRCL came to give us a report that we learned about this proposal. Now, how come we had waited till August 2013 from January 2013? Actually, there's a typo. Now, it says in the paper that the briefing was done in August. No, but actually, it's not August 5th, rather it's the 8th of May. So there was a briefing on the 8th of May. So there's a typo here. It's not the 5th of August. But anyway, our staff conducted visits at the sites from time to time. We also checked progress of MTRC from time to time. Mr. Tan Kapiu, well, in the past few years, the performance of the MTRC was just that it continued to play the government in his hands, play the people in his hands. It's still doing that. Now, it keeps increasing fare, and there are so many incidents involving its train service, and this time they adopt the same mentality. Okay, there's a delay in the project. At the end, it will be the public who pick up the tab. So that's why in the past week or so, we've collected three questions from the public. First of all, whether the government is capable of controlling this monster. One meeting once a month, maybe that shows no respect to the Highways Department. You expressed concern in May, it's only at the end you called the secretary to say that you couldn't manage, but it was a year later. And the second question is, who would pick up the tab for the cost overrun? A third question. Now today, we could also consider the different new rail lines, not including the five new lines. Do we still want to entrust other projects to the MTRCL in this project? There are 13 engineers involved, and you have spent $100 million to hire an independent consultant. Still, this mess has come up, so we don't know if we could still trust the MTRCL. Now, in the paper, you mentioned responsibility. I want you to give an assurance to the taxpayers. Would you exhaust all possible means, including legal means, to recover any loss caused by the project delay, including general damages? What do you mean by general damages? Because you already said 1 year the economic benefit is $2 billion. So 2 years of delay, $4 billion of economic benefits. Would you resort to, would you try to recover all such damages? And then in the two documents, in the annexes, there's mention how you would deal with some delays in the three projects. For example, the MTRCL paper in this annex, 823A, the Yuen Long section. You said you would replace the contractor's project director. You thought by replacing a staff member, it could help the case. So Dr. Raymond Chen, which sounds like a former chairman. I'm not sure if you might become a former chairman soon, but anyway, after Chu Tai Chong has jumped ship, would the board discuss whether you would punish the highest person in charge, Mr. J. Walder? Would you do so? If not, when? If so, when? Otherwise, when would Mr. Walder's contract end? If he could not put up with this pressure, how much notice must he give before he could quit? So please give us the information. Piro, first about new rail projects. Mr. Chairman, of course we're doing, Secretary, no, my question is, for this case, if there's a cost overrun, you say you're seeking advice from the Secretary for Justice, would you not rule out any legal means to claim damages? Well, for any contractual relations, any contractual documents, any contractual rights, of course, we will certainly exercise our full contractual rights in protecting our interests. Dr. Chen? About Mr. J. Walder, CEO, in the past 2 years and a half, he's the leader of the MTR team. In the past 2 years and a half, to be fair, the performance of the MTRCL, you know, and all the difficulties that the team encountered, he tried to overcome these challenges and difficulties. And in our report, we made it clear that we must apologize, that in terms of communication and giving account to the public, we have serious failings. And the board of directors has already set up an independent committee composed of non-executive directors to review all these problems. Now, on project delay, I could say that it's not because the MTR has failed in any way in its project management, but rather we have encountered many challenges. Now, in our data room, all this information will be made available, and we welcome LegCo members to come and study these materials. What about the contract of Mr. J. Walder? When might it expire? Dr. Chen. I think it should be 2015. Which month? I can't recall. In your review, would it include how you deal with Mr. J. Walder? Well, in our review, definitely. It's about
when the management team reporting issues to the board of directors, perhaps there wasn't timely communication. So in this respect, we will conduct a review. And now for us, what is most important is, you know, in terms of the commitment of the MTRCL to Hong Kong, is that there are five important projects that we must complete. So our focus now is on how we could deploy our resources and our talents to complete these five projects. Is it the case that someone is too big to fail? Would you do something about Mr. J. Ward? Would you reveal that arrangement? Yes or no? Now, if in terms of management, there is any mistake. Now, we are not a review committee as such. The MTRCR has a mechanism of its own in place to deal with performance appraisal of the management team. We do have a mechanism. Thank you.
Ms. Chen Yuhan, thank you. I'm not a member of this subcommittee, but I'm very concerned about this. I've read the administration's paper and that of the MTRCL. I have some questions. After 2013, government officials have been having meetings with them, and they have asked a lot of questions. In November 2013, over a matter of a few days, officials asked questions. The MTRCL indicated a wish to use the situation to exert pressure on the contractors, but the administration gave them the benefits of the doubt, and now we have this mess. And I said to the secretary that you should give a full and frank account of everything. You should not have given him the benefit of the doubt. Is the secretary trying to protect the negligence of duty of the colleagues of the bureau and the department? Well, I have warned a lot earlier that there may be corruptions and problems with so many infrastructure projects going on. And on the 21st, 22nd of November, the officials identified some problems and they did not get satisfactory answers. The secretary, you gave them the benefit of the doubt. Is it because you're trying to protect your colleague or there are other reasons? Well, I said the benefit, when I give them the benefit of the doubt, I mean benefit of the doubt. So when there is a difference in the assessment of the situation, I gave them the benefit of the doubt, a chance to catch up. In the evening of the 21st, I would defer to Mr. Lai for the details. Chairman. Ms. Chen rightly pointed out that we've asked a series of questions of the representative of the MTRCL. Well, you don't have to tell me what you've set out in the paper. You've already explained to us already. But we have to make a decision. You asked them a series of questions, and they told you that that could be done, but later that proved to be otherwise. And in the subcommittee meeting, we were told that the completion date of 2015 was still one that they adhered to because they were confident. I would like to get some answers. Secretary, let me answer Ms. Chen's question. On the 22nd of November, during the subcommittee meeting, our statement was that the works will complete within 2015 and then it will take 6 to 9 months of testing and trial run. So it depends on whether the works is completed in the middle or the end of 2015, because that will affect the year when service is commissioned. Then I have some questions. Well, there is a dedicated team set up to monitor the progress of this huge project. I just wonder whether the government officials are too soft or the MTRCL is too aggressive. It seems to me that very often you give them a way out. This is problematic. Secretary, I made a judgment call. I have nothing to say. Secretary, it's not just one time. In the paper, we see that on a number of occasions you gave the MTRC a lot of leeway. So I have a lot of doubts. How come you believe them and not us? Mrs. Regina Ip. Secretary, you may only be a secretary in this term, but I'm sure that you are fully aware about the controversy of the XRL project. And the LegCo will react very strongly to cost overrun. When did you inform the senior echelon of the administration? Why did you wait till November? You only informed them in November 2013. Why not earlier? Because this is a very important matter. Why did you take it upon yourself to deal with it? You should not just trust what you're told. You're a grown boy. Well, I've been reflecting on this over the past few days. We have a three-tier mechanism. You'll find the details in the document. Director for Highways holds a monthly meeting. It's a contract coordination. It's the Project Supervision Committee. Questions were asked. And some of these questions about contract management, technical issues, etc. But I believe that they all are very professional in dealing with the issues. What kind of answer is this? It's only a monthly meeting. You should keep an eye on them every week. It's very controversial. During the funding application period, I was surrounded nearly every day. You should inform the high echelon of the administration to keep a close eye on them because the government holds 77% of the shares. It's a major shareholder. After the evening meeting on the 21st of November, we required the administration to supply the detailed information of the recovery or mitigation measures to catch up. I believe that you may criticize us for giving them time to catch up. That's why I said in my opening speech that we think that, it wasn't ideal in the way that we dealt with it. Next, Mr. Chong Kwok Pan. I have two questions. First, for Mr. Raymond Chen. He mentioned about the data room for legislators. Do we have to keep everything confidential? Can members of the public have access to it? Second question. We know that the earliest the works will complete in 2016 with service commission in 2017. I know that there will at least be a cost overrun of tens of billions of dollars. And the secretary said that when catching up, it also depends on the injection of extra resources. That's what the director for highways said. Is it the case that there will be another delay or a bigger cost overrun? Some members said that there is an entrustment agreement between the administration and the MTRCL. So the MTRCL has obligations and responsibilities to the administration. I think it will be very difficult if you come to the LegCo, to the Finance Committee, to get more funding approval for the cost overrun. I'm afraid that the MTRC will have to find a solution themselves. In relation to the data room, we will, as far as possible, put all the documents in the data room. I ask members' understanding because there may be commercial secrets or confidential information because the MTRCL is a listed company. So if you want to have access of certain documents, you will have to sign a confidentiality agreement. The data room is to enable legislators to have first-hand information to perform their duty to monitor the progress of the project. Our principle is that we will enhance transparency. So when it comes to what has been done and the measures taken to catch up time, will be made known to legislators. For the other points, Mr. Walder, please.
If I can take you back to the schedule for this project, we've laid out a schedule which goes from the point here, it's laid out clearly in our paper, through to the operation of passenger service at the end of 2017. We've indicated that there are three critical contracts, contract 826, which is a cross-boundary contract, contract 823A, which is a tunneling contract in the Yunlong area, and contract 810A, which is in the West Kowloon terminus. In putting the new schedule together, we have tried to take account of all known conditions, production rates that are being achieved today, and lay out a schedule that we believe is realistic, achievable, and we can put before this chamber with confidence that it can be delivered. We have also indicated that there are some means by which we might make up some further time if, for example, blasting were to be allowed in the A10A site or the closing of Lynching Road, but we have not counted on that in the schedule that we have put forth. We have also allowed full time for testing and commissioning of the railway to ensure the safe operations when we put the railway into service. This is a plan that our team stands behind, and I will tell you that over the last 2 weeks, I have met with all of the key contractors personally at all of those contracts that I mentioned to seek their agreement, to ensure that they are aligned to this program and that they believe that it is deliverable. And to a person, they have all assured me that they believe this program is deliverable to the schedule that is there.
主席，我想問前主席一句嘢，即係淨係我哋議員。
Just one point, but your time's up. Sorry, but you allow Mr. Tang Kapiu to overrun for over 2 minutes. So is it the case that a legislator signing the confidentiality undertaking can have access to the information, and if it's a member of the public, that's not allowed? That's right. Mr. Frankie Yick. In Annex G of CB1135514-01, I see that there is a timeline. At the start, there was already a delay, and as time goes on, the delay is getting bigger and bigger. I remember back in November in the subcommittee meeting, I and Mr. Lo Wai Kok asked questions of the MTRC about whether the completion date can be achieved. I remember that they gave us a very positive answer, and Mr. Wong Kok Hing said that they are an exemplary, because with manpower shortage, they could still meet the target. And in August 2013, the MTRCL first proposed a partial operating scenario. And in September, they made that proposal again. And it's the case that they were of the view that they would not be able to achieve the target operation date of 2015, and that's why they made the proposal. I want to ask the administration, how come at that point they still did not see that there is a possibility of not achieving the completion date? And after the telephone call, they accepted the completion date of 2015 as achievable. Well, the permanent secretary did not have a chance to answer. He could use my time. And just now I heard from the secretary that he will set up an independent expert panel. It seems that the secretary, you made recommendations for the CE to make the appointment. I think it's not appropriate. I would like to get some clarification. Now we're talking about an investigation into the secretary as well. So I think it will be better for the chief executive to identify a suitable candidate and make the appointment. In November, on the 21st last year, it wasn't in a telephone call between me and Mr. Walder as to what should be said in the 22nd meeting. Over the phone, I said that I did not agree that the subcommittee should be withheld the information of the possible delay. But Mr. Walder said that there should be facts clarified before anything is to be decided. That's why there was a meeting in the evening on the 21st with Mr. Joseph Lai attending to work out the details. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, it's my time. Could you please wait? Your turn will come. In the meeting, the MTRCL repeatedly indicated to us that the tunneling work, once is crossed the border, the corporation will be able to give an assessment of the situation and to catch up as far as possible, and that they were confident to do so. And they asked the administration for a further of 6 months for them to do another to do a further assessment. The conversation was done in good faith. Our judgment was that the MTR team have a sufficient experience in project management, and in the meeting of the 21st of November, they had all the details of the actual progress. They should have the details of the progress, and that's why they, and that it was based on that that they gave us the undertaking. And from the information of the Director for Highways, it may not be in full detail, but they could not rule the possibility about the feasibility of commissioning of service in 2015. Perhaps I would defer to the Director for Highways. Sorry, I just have one question for the Secretary. In relation to the independent expert panel, is it the case that the CE identified the suitable candidates and make appointments?
Yes, I follow what Mr. Yik said, because my role in this process may be a subject of review, so therefore it should be the chief executive who gets in touch with the relevant candidates. So I got what he said. Okay. Next, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. Mr. Chairman. Well, when you buy a flat, what bought a flat? Did Jay Walder help you choose a flat? Now, you wouldn't let Jay Walder recommend to you what properties to buy, right? You earn some $300,000 a month, and those you lead earn a wage of $100,000 or more. So how come you would listen to Jay Walder? You know, the reason you gave was inconceivable. You know, Hong Kong people hired you to be a principal official. You know, as a principal official, you are accountable not to me, of course, but to the chief executive. I'm in no position to hold you accountable. You could still just laugh if I criticize you. But shouldn't you be accountable to the CE? Are you serving the MTRCL or the public? This is someone from the MTRCL. How come you had to listen to him? We own 77% of the shares. After all, we are the majority shareholder. You could dismiss him if you want. You know, I'm asking you. Or you give me all your money and let me invest it for you. Would you do that? How come you don't trust me in investing for you? How come you trust him instead? So I'm asking you. Would you give all your money to me so I'll invest for you? If you will do it, then I'll believe in what you said. Because you are above him, right? This is the monster. This is a monster company. You are supposed to control it. Now, you should be giving them orders. You should be controlling them, checking them. Jay Walder, did you collude with him? Did you give pressure to him? Did you know that he was as soft as tofu? So you knew Anthony Cheung would succumb to you. That's why you did so. So you should be the first to resign. How come you dare threaten government officials? How come you did that? Now you made a mistake, so you should quit. You threatened our government officials. Now I threw hell money at people, I was criticized, but how come you called him and said you didn't agree to him? Now if I want to throw things at John Zhang, I'm free to do so, but you didn't even have to throw things at people, you just call him and order him what to do. Now, when I walked near John Zhang to throw helmet at him, I was chastised by all government officials. But now you actually call to threaten a government official. You know, yes, minister, you know that? It's yes, minister, not no, minister. So what are you two doing? So either he resigns or you resign, Anthony Cheung. Tonight, Auntie Jung, you give me all your assets. You give everything to me. I'll invest for you for 3 months and I'll believe in what you said. Here we're talking about an investment worth over $60 billion. How come you believe in him and not me? And don't you have to check with Siwai Leung? Why didn't you tell Siwai Leung that Jay Walter threatened you? What I should do? Why did you not consult with Siwai Leung? There's someone earning so much, threatening you, earning so much, and there's another person earning so much more above you. He knew nothing. So I think first, Jay Walter must quit. If he doesn't quit, you must quit. Either one of you must quit, or both of you should quit. And Yao Sheng Mo, well, we will deal with him later. I've never heard something so ridiculous, honestly. Now, property agent asked me to buy property. Maybe you say, Mr. Leung, you know, this is an excellent property. There's a huge potential. But it's a waste of time. So, Jay Walter, you have to quit because you threaten a government official, and he's so stupid, he lets you threaten him, so he must resign too. Next, Mr. Sit Ho. I read the independent review report of the Highways Department dated April 2014, so it has to be the latest. On page 26, contract 810A is mentioned, the progress. Paragraphs B and C says here there's a difference of 4 months, but later on, it couldn't even say how much delay there was. It couldn't say when works might be completed, but just now the MTR has been telling us that they could recover the progress. So what do you think, Highways Department? Is the report dated April? Still, you couldn't tell us when, how much the delay was. You just said the progress was sluggish. So we're hearing two different stories here today. And then the administration submitted a paper to the Finance Committee in 2009-10, seeking funds. And you say that by 2013-14, for this $55 billion of railway project, you should have used up 97% of the money by 2013-14. So you should have used up 79% rather of the funds. And now we are in May 2014, so you should be using funds for 2014-15. So my question for the administration of MTRCL is this. Have you spent all that 79% of the funds? If you have, now just for the West Kowloon terminus alone, you do not know when works will be completed. And you tell us there's a shortfall of $3.4 billion. Did you overestimate then, or are you underestimating now? Or are you just coming up with any arbitrary figures just to, you know, say something to us? So at this point, you're still underestimating things. And you're saying that for the contingency fee, it may just be an overrun of about $3.4 billion. Now, actually, for many projects, there's been substantial cost overrun. This funding request of $66.8 billion, it was in 2010. Now it's been 4 years. So, up till now, you never told us there's any cost overrun until the delay was exposed. Only now you're saying so. So come clean now, MTRC and administration. When would the works be completed and how much would be the cost overrun? Now, you've hired so many consultants, investigation consultants and so on. This cost overruns. Should you not try to recover them through legal means from the consultants? Who's to answer, please? Secretary, on the report... Perhaps first talk about 810 before we talk about cost overrun. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If I could spend a bit of time on the monitoring mechanism. In the paper, we've explained the mechanism, but I'll be very brief here. In 2008, we commissioned a consultant to see how we should entrust the project to the MTRCL. It is about the institutional arrangement. The consultant believed the MTRCL had a sound system. Yes, it's all in the report. I've read it. So what I'd like to reiterate here, page 26, paragraphs B and D and E. You know, when do you think the works will be completed? Now, what I'm trying to say is that in our monitoring mechanism, yes, we have set up a 13-member team, but then they could not really do all the monitoring. The monitoring mechanism is just to monitor the MTRCL in carrying out the works. If you look at the records, the MTRCL needs a huge team of 800 to 900 people to monitor the work. So for our team of 13, we couldn't get over, you know, keep tab of all the information. There's still 6 minutes left, and Mr. Tony Hsieh has not yet spoken. So we have 6 minutes left. Mr. Tony Hsieh has not spoken. And after he's spoken, there will be 2 minutes left. It's his first time, so I'll let him speak. But Mr. Wu Chi-wai and Mr. Gary Fang, you would like us to recommend to the House Committee to invoke the powers and privileges ordinance, but actually you've already written to the House Committee yourself. So is there still a need for us to do so here? This is a well-considered motion, because at the House Committee meeting this Friday on the 9th of May, Mr. Andrew Leung, the chairman of the House Committee, has not given me approval to raise the item. So that's why I must do this. Okay, 6 minutes. Mr. Tony Jay, and he will take 4 minutes, and there will still be 2 minutes left. If members have no objection, then I can extend the meeting by 15 minutes. So or we deal with the motion next time. Mr. Tony Jay? Sorry? I'm against extending the meeting by 15 minutes. So you don't agree? Well, Mr. Tony Jay has walked in and he hasn't spoken. So, thank you, Mr. Chairman, because there are other meetings going on as well. So that's why I came in late. I've read the documents. The impression I gather is that it's really not satisfactory. Or rather, is quite a mess. Now, I refer to the paper dated the 16th of April 2010. It was a paper submitted to the administration, to the Legislative Council. It said that the administration would monitor the work of the MTRCR to make sure that the works are carried out in accordance with the approved project estimate, is of good quality, and it will be completed on time. So it's done something like the Director of Highways lead a team of 13, we just heard, and then there are other colleagues involved as well, of course, in overseeing the projects. And then they've also commissioned a consultant, Jacob. And Jacobs China Limited, that's the consultant engaged by the Highways Department. Now, from the paper, we understand that the director will look at the consultant's assessments to assess the progress of works and whether there might be delay. Okay, so you have an external consultant, and then within the Highways Department, you have your expertise on such matters. Then we see in the past many projects have suffered delay. Perhaps the MTRCR might have recovery measures to catch up with the delay. But then I don't see that the Highways Department or the consultant have assessed whether the recovery measures were effective. So it seems strange. It's over a very short span of time. It said that the delay could be recovered, but then all of a sudden, after a month, it said that the delay would be by more than a year. So it's so strange. And then the Highways Department wanted to ask for the latest program, works program. Still, it couldn't get it yet. So perhaps the MTRCL is, steamrolling its way through. It doesn't even bother to answer the administration. Is that the case? That's a second question. Whether there is any information to show that the consultant and the Highways Department have done any assessment on the assessment of the MTRCL in that it could catch up with the delay. Did the Highways Department or the consultant give any independent assessment to the secretary? We can't see that from the paper. It seems that they are being led by the MTRCL. Whatever the MTRCL says, they just listen or agree. Or if the MTRCL say all of a sudden there will be a delay of 1 year, over such a short span of time, they change their position. It can't be. If initially they said there's a delay of 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, fine. But how come all of a sudden now it's from 2015 to 2017? It's so abrupt. So, in terms of monitoring, what is the situation like? I'd like to know. And on the part of the MTRCL, is it the case that MTRCL has all the say? If it says it can keep catch up with progress, fine, it can. If not, it's for the MTRCL to say. So it's the only party to make the call. It seems that's the case from the paper. Now MTRCL tells us they can't meet the deadline, so that's it. You've exhausted your time. It's now 6:45. Now, a member doesn't support extending the meeting. But then for members moving motions, you have to understand there were other members joining us later. I had to give them a chance to speak. So now, do you agree that we have another meeting on the 19th of May? Those in favor, hands up, please. Hands up, please. Those in favor of another meeting on the 19th of May, hands up. Because, but you can still extend the meeting by 15 minutes, but the members raised opposition. But we all know we don't have enough time. You allow more to speak. Originally, you said that after we finished with the questions, we'd deal with the motion. Now you're going back on your words.
They said you know.
If you renege, well, I know that some more people ask questions, but I cannot control who would come in and speak. I did as far as I could. Without the couple of members, we would have had some time. And now we only had, all we need is just another 10 minutes. Unless all of us leave now, then there is nothing I can say. Then the meeting will be aborted. But unless that happens, we can stay here and deal with the motion. Well, you can all simply leave. Then there is nothing I can do, but I remind you that we're all being filmed. Well, my understanding is that if there is one member objecting to a further extension, then we cannot do so. Members join us, and they spoke for the first time. I could not stop them, and I kept the speaking time to 3 minutes. Just now, 9 members agree to have a continuation of the meeting on the 19th of May. I criticise you, Chairman. You make use of the procedure for the benefit of the MTRCL. You said at the outset that you would draw a line, and 16 members raised their hands. You said that the motion would be put to a vote at 6:30, and the meeting would be extended for 15 minutes. Why did you not keep to your words? And you allow members to speak. Mr. Fan, members join us and they were speaking for the first time and they should be allowed to do so. But you have drawn a line. I did not say that. When you have made a very clear calculation of the time, so 16 members, 4 minutes, we will have 18 minutes left, and that would take us to 6:30, and then it will be put to a vote. Mr. Fan, let me tell you that at the beginning there were only 16 members. So that would take us 60 minutes or so, so I have put in place sufficient time to deal with the motion. But I could not control as to whether new members would join. But one member spoke for 6.5 minutes. And for others, you stop them even if they overrun by 1 second. But some members spoke for up to 6 minutes, Mr. Chen Kam Lam. This is outside the the meeting time. Unless there is no objection, the meeting cannot be further extended. But we got an objection from Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, so I say I adjourned the meeting. I criticize you, member. You deliberately do it in a way to benefit the administration.